1850s to the 1920s, Clerkenwell and the Hatton Garden end of Holborn was something of a little Italy, with a high concentration of immigrants clustering around the Italian church in Hatton Wall. By the latter end of the period, some of the young sons of the respectable frame makers and statuaries had been influenced by our native traditions and turned to crime. Darby Sabini came to lead one of the most notorious gangs of the early interwar years. Like most professional gangs, the Sabini mob occasionally conducted territorial wars with other mobs, and they needed soldiers. The young boxer, Cecil Louis England, found his métier with them as a minder, a bouncer, and a general roughneck. But to work for the Sabinis, he followed the example of contemporary musicians and ballet dancers and Italianized his name. He became Tony Mancini. As an underworld enforcer, Mancini built a reputation for ruthless cruelty. Once he turned the handle of a meat mincer while colleagues held an opposing gangster's hand inside. On another occasion, he accepted a commission to mark for life a man who'd informed on one of the Sabini's family. Mancini went into a bar where the narc was drinking, took a hatchet from his pocket, and struck off the man's hand, which was resting on the pub bar. Then he strolled out to the getaway car awaiting him and left the weapon embedded in the bar counter. As usual, when villains have established control over a territory, the bar staff and other customers were afraid to give evidence, and the boys supplied Mancini with a cast-iron alibi. Mancini moved west to work for other London demi-mondaines in the early 1930s. He claimed that Jack Spot, starting his climb to dominance over 1940s Soho clubland, employed him briefly. And he also served as a bouncer at the Silver Slipper Club in Wardour Street. Here, some East End enemies caught up with him. In a bloody fight, Mancini was severely carved up with a razor, hospitalised, and on his release, looking more flashily villainous than ever, was gently given his cards by the club's manager. A friend of his warned him that the opposition had sworn to kill him. She urged him to join her in Brighton, where she would look after him while he hunted for new employment. After a little hesitation about shifting to the less macho career of poncing, Mancini accepted, and so began his fateful relationship with Violetta E-T-T-E-K. Born Violet, plain E.T., Saunders, she'd been a dancer and a soubrette, until an appetite for alcohol and morphine reduced her to living by prostitution. With fluffy, wistful femininity, she retained a reasonably select clientele, meeting her by appointment only, made over the telephone. "More of a call girl, really," said Mancini, optimistically trying to add a touch of class to his old lady's occupation. At 38, she was 12 years older than her lover, and he probably felt that his new way of life demanded all the enhancement for prestige he could give it. They took a flat in Park Crescent, Brighton, and Mancini looked about for a job that might guarantee his independent manhood. Eventually he found one as a waiter at the Skylark Cafe. Part of his appeal to the management was his reputation as a hard man. Home life with Violette deteriorated. Ladylike and raffined when sober, she was foul-mouthed and violent when drunk. Ultimately she would fall down and wet herself. The young crook's self-esteem was severely damaged by the observation that he was living with and off a middle-aged woman who could be, in his word, disgusting. He took to staying out at nights. He started having little flings with other women. Violet quarrelled about this. On May the 10th, 1934, she came to the Skylark and made a drunken row in front of the staff and customers. Mancini was furious. When he got home that night, she was still drunk and started to abuse him all over again. In the course of the row, she picked up the coal hammer from the scuttle and threw it at him. Mancini went into a red rage, and according to two separate confessions he made 40 and 50 years later, he either threw the hammer back, catching Violet lethally on the side of the head, or he knocked her down and furiously beat her head against a knob on the fender until her skull cracked. Probably he did both. No one has ever seriously accused him of patience, equanimity, or squeamishness. With a body on his hands, Mancini hastened to pack it away in a trunk and to announce to all who cared that Violet had left him and gone to new employment in Paris. He even sent her sister a telegram to this effect. As the trunk began to smell, he changed his lodgings, claiming that the heavy load he transported consisted of his books and some leaky cleaning fluid that accounted for the noxious odour. 1934 was a bad year to have a body on your hands in Brighton. A number of women had disappeared. A number had been found murdered, and all but the head and legs of one was found in a trunk in the left luggage office at the railway station. As routine inquiries reached him, Mancini took fright and fled. The police found Miss Kay, traced Mancini, arrested him, and charged him. Newspaper reporters, knowing Mancini's frightful reputation in the underworld, had a field day. They were less inhibited by libel laws than is the case today, when evil villains might extract large sums of money from honest journalists who tell the truth, and judges, who almost never sent forward recommendations for perjury prosecutions, will nonetheless hold newspapers in contempt of court unless they describe sworn testimony as allegations. The press described Mancini in detail. Remarkably, they attributed rather too much villainy to him, and they erroneously suggested that he was responsible for the body found in the railway station. But Mancini's stroke of real good fortune was that Norman Burkitt appeared for him, and made it the most brilliant defence plea of his career. Burkitt made the most of Mancini's lurid press personality, his morally offensive life of poncing and petty crime, and then, like a conjurer drawing a rabbit from a hat, had the police themselves confirm that he had never been convicted of a violent crime. Burkitt produced a witness to assert that Mancini's blood-stained clothing had all been acquired after Violet's death. He suggested fruitfully that her injuries might easily have resulted from a drunken fall down the area steps. He pointed out that it was essentially Mancini's own trail of lies and deception which cast serious doubt on his claim to have found Violet dead in the flat when he returned from work. He made it seem perfectly plausible that such a man should assume that a bad record would be held against him and plummet into an ill-advised maelstrom of lies. He was helped by Mancini's superb performance in the witness box, where he never contradicted himself, and managed to sound utterly convincing as he claimed to have loved Violet and to recognise his own general worthlessness, yet to have always stayed on the right side of actual violence. Why did Burkitt save the savage little murderer? During his lifetime, it was said that he'd seen the papers and became convinced that an innocent man was liable to be hanged because of an irrelevant criminal record. Since his death, it's been suggested that he was not especially satisfied with the case. May one suspect that he recognised that defence triumphs like Marshall Hall's were the making of a great reputation and a great career, that the law did not insist that he be over-scrupulous about reasonable doubts he felt personally, and that a seasoned professional villain might be relied upon not to trip into unnecessary confession once he had a plausible denial in the public arena? In any event, he won a rapid acquittal for his client, and the astonished murderer left the dock, repeating, "Not guilty, Mr. Burkitt. Not guilty, Mr. Burkitt."